Welcome to r/maliciouscompliance, where we share stories of people conforming to the letter, but not the spirit of a request. And today we have three great stories. So subscribe, hit the like button, and let's begin. The first story. Client wanted to ask the boss to fire me, but he did not know that it was my father. The second story. Bowling lane damaging my old bowling ball. Manager says to keep bowling. Ball can't be fixed. Get a crazy awesome new ball for cheap as a result. The third story. Company let me go on the spot and paid me 2 weeks without asking what I was actively working on. Today's first story is, you can absolutely wait to speak to the owner. I was attending grad school at the time to finish my doctoral degree, which I'm only mentioning is relevant because the customer made a crack about intelligence. While working at my father's business, an auto salvage yard, our yard was located in New Jersey, and this event occurred in August, so it was hot and very humid. I was generally very dirty when I was at work with grease and grime all over my arms and clothes. If you washed your hands and arms every time they looked dirty, your skin would just get dry and irritated, so with the exception of stopping to eat, I was absolutely filthy all day long. Our yard mostly dealt with shops and small independent mechanics, who came in looking just as dirty as I was, so it was completely normal. Another point relevant to this story is this. I look absolutely nothing like my father. He's 5'8 and weighs at most 140 pounds, and I'm 6'2 and back then I was powerlifting, and weighed right around 220 pounds. So here's my story. A guy comes in to pick up something he bought when I was not there, that had to be taken out of a car. I don't even remember what it was now, but it was something fairly heavy. For him, not for me. And dirty. If we had parts in our warehouse, they'd get scrubbed and cleaned, by me, before being labeled and cataloged. But parts coming right off a car just had the loose grime knocked off. So the guy comes in looking very out of place for our yard, wearing a button-down shirt, khakis, and dress shoes. He hands me his receipt, and I tell him I'll bring it out the side door. I walk out with his item on a hand truck, and the only vehicle I see parked is an Acura sedan, very unlike the beat-up shop vehicles most of our customers drove. The guy's walking around the front of his car talking on his phone, but the trunk is open, so I bring the hand truck around and leave his item on the ground with a piece of cardboard to keep his trunk clean and go back inside. A few minutes later, the customer comes inside wanting to know what he's supposed to do with the part, to which I facetiously reply, "Install it, I imagine." He wants to know why the part is dirty. I reply, "It's used." He wants to know how he's supposed to get it home. I reply, "In your car." He wants to know why I didn't put the item in his truck, and I point to the sign behind him, which admittedly is partially obscured by the open door, which says that we're not responsible for loading parts due to liability for possible damage to the customer's vehicle. He turns around looking peeved and shouts, "What am I supposed to do now, genius?" Because I must be dumb if I'm dirty, right? There are now two other customers by the office, and I know them both well, so I tell them I'll be right with them and walk around outside to the guy's car, because I just want him gone. I throw a blanket over the rear bumper of his car, remind him that I'm not liable for damage, and I lift the piece up and gently put it on the cardboard in his car. To do this without damaging anything, I had to put one of my hands on the side of the trunk, and I left a huge greasy handprint, largely on purpose. While I'm loading, he's standing so close to me supervising that my arm bumps his arm and his sleeve gets dirty. The entire time this exchange has been going on, he's been on his phone, and he's now ranting into his phone about our interaction, and he calls me genius again, and I reply, "You came to a salvage yard to pick up a heavy, dirty, used part in dress clothes with a luxury car. Who's the genius?" At that point, he also noticed the grease on his car and his dirty sleeve, and he wants to know if the owner is here, and I tell him Bob is working out in the yard. He demands to speak to him, and I say fine. We walk back around to the office, and I point to Bob, who's way out in the yard on the forklift moving cars that are going to the crusher. This is time sensitive because the truck will come to pick them up and block the entire street while we load, so we have to be ready. He starts to walk into the yard, and I try to stop him and tell him it's too dangerous. He keeps walking, so I point out that our Doberman is trotting along behind the forklift. She was actually our dog from home, and very friendly, but we brought her with us every day, because we couldn't get home to let her out. He sees the dog and stops, and I tell the guy he has to wait until Bob has finished moving vehicles, and it'll be a while, which he says is fine because he's going to tell Bob exactly how his customers are being treated. Over the next 40 minutes, I walk past the guy multiple times helping customers, and each time I pass him, he mutters something about me being fired and me being sorry. Finally, the forklift shuts down, and Bob stands up, and my new friend seems ecstatic, banging on the counter and telling me that Bob is done, and he wants to speak to him immediately. I walk outside with my new friend right next to me, climb up on a car's fender and wave my arms to get Bob's attention and scream, "Hey Dad, this guy wants to talk to you." And with that, my new buddy says F you, turns and walks out, hops in his car and guns it up the street. Deep down, I wanted my father to come talk to him, but my dad would have known something was up if I had called him Bob. My dad's a really nice guy, but he has an awful temper. He has a temper at times, but my dad is hilarious. The next story is, keep bowling, the pro shop will fix it. Okay. When I was younger and through my early to mid-adult years, I was an avid bowler. 200 plus average back when that actually meant you were good, before the bowling ball technology boom, which comes into play here. And I work at the local bowling center from the time I was 16 through 21 or so. And then again later on in my early 20s, working the back, pin setters, front of the house, etc. So knew how things operated, what could go wrong, etc. I was bowling at a different center one day. The first frame after each shot, my ball came back with a small nick out of it. Nothing major, but yeah. So I put the ball away and brought out an old ball that I never used, but was in one of my bags. Next two or three shots, another nick each time. Fourth frame, it finally came back with a fairly large chunk taken out of it. Usually that means there's a nail or a screw that's worked its way loose, and the ball is catching on it, or a piece of metal is broken near the ball lift and is cutting into it. I take the ball up to the counter and tell the manager, and show him what had happened. Now, I was only four frames into the game, and said I would move, and he said no, they couldn't move me, as they had a party coming in and no lanes available. He said just keep bowling and the pro shop will repair the ball. I asked if he was sure. He said yup, he'll go in and tell them to fix it, and the center would pay for it. Most pro shops are individually owned and operated. The owner rents the space from the center. This was no exception. Now, having done simple pro shop work, I know for a fact there's no way it can be fixed if I keep bowling with it, and this keeps happening. One gouge can be repaired fairly easily, as long as it's not in the track of the ball. The track is the contact point where your ball rolls down the lane, so anything in that line just can't be fixed, and will throw the ball off as it rolls, since it can't be perfectly rounded back. Depending on the core of the ball and how you throw it, the track can be 3 to 4 inches wide, as the ball flares going down the lane. But massive multiple gouges all over the place? Nope. So I keep bowling, two or three games, knowing that I'm getting a new bowling ball out of this. Of course, the huge chunks keep coming out of the ball. I get finished, and there probably isn't a 2-inch by 2-inch section of the ball that isn't damaged. I take the ball into the pro shop and the conversation goes, "Pro shop guy, what the hell happened to this ball? Did it get hung up in the pin setter or something?" Me, the lane I was on damaged it each time I threw it. The manager said you would fix it. Pro shop guy, why did you keep bowling? I can't fix this. Me, the manager told me to keep bowling after I showed him the first gouge. Pro shop guy then calls the manager of the center. Pro shop guy, I know you said he was bringing in a damaged ball, but did you tell him to keep bowling after you saw the damage? Center manager, yeah, we couldn't move him, so I told him to just bowl out his games and you would fix it. Pro shop guy, I can't fix this, you're gonna have to replace his ball. Manager, what? Bunch of arguing back and forth about why it can't be fixed. The ball I have they don't carry, etc. Fine, replace it with anything on the wall except for the Excalibur. The Excalibur was almost 50% more expensive than regular bowling balls. It was the first reactive resin ball on the market. Reactive resin is a compound that made the ball hook much, much more than a traditional urethane ball. It revolutionized the game, and ruined it according to some, since it allowed average and below average bowlers to suddenly improve drastically due to not having to be anywhere near as accurate and took a lot of the skill from the game. But I digress. Me, so I can pick any other ball other than the Excalibur and you'll pay for it, drilling and all? Manager, yes. Me, okay, thanks. Manager leaves. Me, can I have store credit for that ball on the wall, but then apply it to the Excalibur and I'll pay the difference? Pro shop guy, sure, we can do that. And proceeds to measure my hand and drills the ball, and I pay like 40 bucks for what was then between a $150 to $200 ball that I could not have afforded at the time. Bowled my second ever 300 game with it less than a month later, and won two center tournaments with it, and a bunch of high game pot money during league play. That ball paid for itself 10 times over in the first 2 months. The last story is, might make sure you know what I'm working on before letting me go. I was working for a logistics company several years ago. They went through a merger and wound up shutting our office down. They presented it to us like they were doing us a favor and expected me to pick up and move states to keep working with them. That obviously wasn't in the cards, so what happened next was a bit of fun. When we got the email talking about the merger, I had my reservations. When we got a second email indicating that the company president, VP, head of sales, and an HR supervisor were all coming down to meet our 8-person office, I clearly saw the writing on the wall. You don't send that type of firepower if something great is happening. The day of the meeting comes up, and they told us that due to the merger, they were shutting down our office, but we could go to any of the other offices they or the new company had. I wasn't 100% not going to move, but I wanted to know my options. To say they weren't prepared for this meeting is an understatement. I asked them several questions that were critical to me making a decision on my future within the next 5 days. 1. Will you pay my moving expenses? 2. Will you pay to break my lease? This was March, and I renewed my lease in February. 3. Will you pay cost of living adjustments if average costs are higher where I go? The answer to all three was initially, we don't know. We'll have to get back to you. This was on a Friday, and they told me by the end of the day I would have my answers. Shockingly enough, come Monday, I did not have these answers. I told this to my local manager, and he cussed under his breath and hopped on the phone. About 30 minutes later, I get my answers. 1. No. 2. No. 3. No. While I had expected these answers, I could tell they did not expect my next question. By the merger, I had just gone over 3 years within the company. I asked them what the severance package looked like. One more time, I was told, we don't know. We'll have to get back to you. A couple of hours later, they offered me 1 month's salary, not factoring in my commissions, which had exceeded my salary. Not only did they offer me scraps, they wanted me to sign a new non-compete with all sorts of new teeth. Needless to say, I told them no thanks to all of it. This made them mad, and they told me that I could turn in my stuff and would be paid for the next 2 weeks. What they didn't know, or ask, is what I was working on. In the business, it's typically very easy to pick up the ball for someone else. Unknown to them, I was working on an incredibly complicated project, moving a portable air traffic control tower from Jacksonville to Puerto Rico. This is also a government project, since it's involving airports, so all the T's needed to be crossed, along with all the I's dotted. To get this down to PR, we put it on a barge. This thing was basically a massive camper, converted with a pop-up tower and all sorts of electronics, if you're trying to imagine it, oversized and needing permits to move. I honestly can't tell you what happened from this point. I never found out. All I can do is sit around from time to time and chuckle about how whoever tried to pick up my slack stepped into a hornet's nest, the likes of which I couldn't have set up had I planned and tried. They let me go on the spot, since they didn't want me harvesting info to poach customers and start my own gig. What they didn't know is that I knew all of this was coming and had already printed out everything I needed several days before. Had they asked me to see this thing through, I probably would have. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if you liked it, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon.